Hi all. In this video, we start with the activities in the large intestine. Okay, so we will look at the secretions of the large intestines and the movements of the large intestine, and especially like the conditions like diarrhea, constipation, and defecation process. Okay, so those are the topics that we want to do it in this video. Okay, so let's first start with the secretions of the large intestine. Okay, so the major one of the important thing that get secreted is the mucus secretion. Okay, so in the large intestine have like crypts of Lieberkin with lots of goblet cells. The goblet cells are the one that secretes the mucus, secreting lot of mucus with moderate amount of bicarbonate ions. Okay, so very importantly, when you have like diarrhea, what you lose is like bicarbonate ions can be lost. Okay, so what will happen when the bicarbonate is lost from the body, it will cause, bicarbonate is an acid, so it will cause what? Acidosis. Okay, so because you are losing alkali, so not only bicarbonate, you will also lose potassium ions. Okay, so you will have a loss of bicarbonate with potassium ions, K plus and the bicarbonate will be lost along with sodium and the water. Okay, now what is the role of this mucus? It acts as an adherent medium for holding the fecal matter together and also for the lubrication of the movement of the particles within the tract. Okay, so let's look at the daily turnover of in the GIT. Okay, so you can see the amount of water that you normally drink is approximately around 2000 ml or like 2 liters. Okay, so whereas far more than that, you have around 7 liters of water getting secreted from the intestines. Okay, from the small intestine. So salivary gland secreted amounts like 1500 in a day, stomach produces 2500 in a day, 500 ml of bile is produced, 1500 of pancreatic juice, and the intestinal secretions, okay, you have like around 1000 ml. Okay, so that makes a total of 7000. Okay, and total input is like 9000. Okay, so how much is like around reabsorbed is around 8800. Where is the major reabsorption taking place? That is in the jejunum and ileum. Okay, and a little bit in the colon. Okay, so colon is not the major part, but the jejunum and the ileum. Okay, and almost like 8800, that is like 200 ml of the blood will be removed in the stool. Okay, so that is the normal turnaround of the water. So you have a question over here that asking you about this same concept. Okay, so the figure over here shows the amount of water. The figure shows the amount of water ingested and secreted daily into the GI tract by a healthy individual. Since about 100 ml of water is excreted daily in the stool, so which of the following volumes best reflects the daily absorbed water indicated in the areas X, Y, Z and GI? Okay, so over here you can see like 1500 ml of saliva is being secreted, gastric juice is around 2 liters, bile is like 500 ml, intestinal secretion of around like 1500 ml. Okay, and a pancreatic juice of around 1500 ml. So total is like 9000 ml is being secreted. Okay, so now in this part, this part is called as the esophagus and the stomach. Okay, esophagus and the stomach. So X. So normally we don't absorb like much water over here. Okay, so we don't absorb much water over here. Okay, and this is your small intestine. Okay, this is your small intestine and this is your large intestine. Okay, so we have just now studied where do we have more, the more reabsorption takes place in the small intestine, and this is your large intestine. Okay, the colon is the large intestine, so this will be much more and this will be comparatively less. Okay, so let's look at the answer choices over here. Okay, so this is our answer choices over here. So you can see A, this is good, this is good. Okay, these are wrong. Okay, these are wrong because in the esophagus and the mouth or in the stomach, you don't absorb much water. Okay, you don't absorb the water at all. Okay, so here you can see the Y, that means the small intestine is less compared to that of the large intestine, but that is wrong, right? So that is wrong. So instead, you have small intestine having more absorption compared to that of the large intestine. So this is your option. The correct option will be the B. Okay, so just to give you an idea how the questions will be framed on these small informations that you have to be careful about. Okay, let's go on. Okay, so let's look at into like how this water is, like the water is being absorbed as well as being secreted. So the water is going in as well as getting absorbed. Okay, so let's first look into the absorption. Okay, so the point over here you must remember is wherever the sodium chloride goes, the sodium is moving, what will follow? The water will follow that. Okay, water will follow the sodium and the chloride. So electroneutral absorption in the small intestine. Okay, electroneutral absorption of the sodium chloride. So the sodium chloride will tell you the direction of the water. So here you are absorbing the water along with sodium chloride. Okay, so what happens over here? So this is your luminal side. Okay, this is your lumen and this is your luminal membrane and this is your blood side. Okay, it's being absorbed into the blood. Okay, or the interstitial fluid is present over here. Okay, so what are those channels that is causing this to happen? Okay, so we have the sodium hydrogen exchanger. Okay, the sodium hydrogen exchanger, which is absorbing the sodium and secreting the hydrogen ion. The hydrogen ion is being secreted and the sodium is reabsorbed. Okay, so now there is what happens, this type of a channel, when it is dependent, this is called as a secondary active transport. This is a secondary active transport because the sodium is moving in and you need to create a deficiency of sodium here. So you need the primary, the ATPase to work. Okay, this is the primary active. Okay, this is the primary active. Okay, so primary active transport, which is pumping the sodium out and the potassium in. Okay, so this is how you absorb the sodium. Okay, so now when the sodium is being absorbed, what will follow that? Okay, the chloride will follow that. Okay, so you have a congenital chloride deficiency, that channel. Okay, if this is deficient, okay, this is a chloride channel. Okay, if this is deficient, what will happen? You cannot absorb the chloride, and what will happen? The chloride and the sodium will accumulate over here and can cause diarrhea. So this is like a congenital problem, a deficiency of this. So this is called as a congenital chloride diarrhea. Okay, so because these channels are deficient, congenital diarrhea you can get. Okay, so this chloride is exchanged with bicarbonate. Okay, so this is exchanged with bicarbonate. So that's why we are calling here, like what, when a positive is going out, a positive is coming in, when a negative is going out, a negative is coming in. So that is why it is being referred to as what, electroneutral. Okay, so this is like an electroneutral mechanism. Okay, so now the sodium is coming in and the potassium has been like taken in. So what you should do with the potassium also has to go out. Okay, and potassium chloride co-transporter. Okay, so they are transporting together. So that's why it is called as a co-transporter. Again, a secondary active transport. So this is the potassium and the chloride being absorbed back to the blood. Okay, so this is how. So what will follow now? The sodium has been coming to the blood. So what will follow? The water will follow. Sometimes the water will follow this in between the cell, the paracellular route. Okay, instead of the transcellular, it can also go through the paracellular. Okay, so the water will follow the sodium and the chloride. Okay, so this is the electroneutral. Okay, so just to give you some brief idea about the applied aspect of this. So this one already we have discussed, congenital chloride diarrhea. Okay, so you can get congenital problem here. So another thing is, there are certain toxins that can block this channel. Okay, so for example, E. coli toxin or the cholera toxin, etc., will block what, the sodium hydrogen exchanger. So what cannot be absorbed, these toxins, if they block this, the sodium cannot be absorbed. So if the sodium does not get absorbed, what will happen? You have more sodium over here. Okay, the more sodium in the lumen, and the sodium will hold the water, and the water and the chloride and the sodium will be excreted out. Okay, so that is the problem in this, if you block this. So what are the examples of the toxins that can block your sodium hydrogen exchanger? It can be blocked by the cholera toxin. Okay, cholera toxin, and by the E. coli. Okay, the E. coli toxin, Escherichia coli, E. coli toxin can block these channels. Okay, so that is one way of like absorbing the sodium chloride. That is the electroneutral mechanism. Okay, now let us discuss about another mechanism of absorbing the sodium. Okay, sodium when you absorb, chloride will follow, water will follow that. Okay, so this is electrogenic. So this is not like neutral way of absorbing, it's electrogenic. So you're just absorbing the sodium without like concentrating whether the sodium and the chloride is following or there is an equal distribution of a positive and negative. No, nothing. Just like absorb the sodium. Okay. So in order to do that, what is there? You keep an epithelial sodium channel called as what? The ENaC. The ENaC is lodged on the luminal membrane with the help of aldosterone. Okay. The aldosterone is responsible for that. Okay. Aldosterone can lodge this channel. Okay, so the aldosterone will come and act on the DNA and cause the transcription translation to increase this channel, the ENaC channel, which will cause the entry of the sodium alone. And the sodium is then pumped out of the body through the sodium potassium ATPase. Okay, ATPase, and the potassium is also transported out through the other potassium channels. Now, what will happen? The chloride and the water will follow the sodium through the paracellular route. Okay, so following a low salt diet, increased expression of ENaC, okay, in response to aldosterone increases the ability to reclaim sodium from the fecal matter, from the large intestine. Okay, so that is the role of aldosterone. Okay, it's an importance of the aldosterone, and that type is called as referred as what? Electrogenic. So this is hormonally controlled mechanism of absorbing sodium chloride and the water. Okay, so now we have seen how to absorb the water. Okay, now let us look at how is the secretion of this happening. Okay, how to secrete the fluid and electrolytes into the small intestine or the large intestine. So we need to make an adjustment. So we have seen like almost 7000 ml of secretions going in and like and making it into 9000 plus 2000 plus 7000, and out of that almost 8800 is reabsorbed, right? So now how to like go to cause that 7000 ml of the fluid to be secreted. Okay, so here what follows? The paracellular route. What follows? The sodium, because of the chloride. The chloride is going in. So in order to get the chloride to the cell, what we have a transporter called as one sodium, one potassium and two chloride co-transporter. So the sodium and the potassium and the chloride, so two chloride. Okay, so sodium, potassium and 2 chloride co-transporter will transport all these things into the cell. Okay, now what will happen to the sodium and the potassium? That will get exchanged over here. The sodium potassium pump is driving that. Okay, so this is your primary active. Okay, and this is the secondary active transporter that is bringing the chloride ions here. Okay, and the potassium usually leaves the cell. Okay, back to the blood. Okay, now there is a special channel that is present over here called as what? CFTR channel, chloride channels. Okay, these are the special chloride channel that is present over here that cause the secretion. Okay, so what does CFTR stands for? Cystic fibrosis transmembrane regulator protein. Okay, so this is like controlled by a regulator protein that is like affected in a disease condition called as what? Cystic fibrosis. Okay, cystic fibrosis. Okay, so maybe you might have heard about the cystic fibrosis condition. Like maybe it may be common in like Ashkenazi Jew, so maybe like you may see that word in the vignette. Okay, Ashkenazi Jew or like something European descent and etc. will have like high incidence of cystic fibrosis. Okay, so the cystic fibrosis transmembrane regulator channel is bringing the chloride. Okay, this transporter is bringing the chloride to the lumen. Okay, and the sodium. Okay, so now where do we get this transport channel? What is the mechanism of action of that? Okay, how do we get that? So this is done by whenever there is like less fluid over here, less water over here, this causes irritation to these receptors. Okay, so these the villi or the epithelium will be irritated because of the lack of water over here. So that will cause what? A stimulation and cause the activation of adenyl cyclase. Adenyl cyclase then cause the conversion of ATP to cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP. Okay. And then the cyclic AMP then cause the helping of the lodging of these channels through the CFTR. Okay. So that is how the chloride is being secreted. Okay. So now in a disease conditions like or a toxins like again like the previous toxin that we have discussed, like the cholera toxin. Okay, the cholera toxin or the E. coli toxin. Okay, the E. coli toxin. What do they do? they enhances, okay, enhances this one. So they stimulate, these toxins will stimulate, these toxins will stimulate the adenylyl cyclase. When they stimulate the adenylyl cyclase, what will happen? It will cause an increased conversion of ATP to cyclic AMP. And then what will happen? The cyclic AMP will stimulate the increased lodging of the chloride channels. Okay, so that is how. So when you have an increased chloride channels, the sodium will follow and the water will follow, and you get diarrhea. So that is why you get watery diarrhea in the case of cholera or the E. coli. Okay, so that is the mechanism how this is causing the diarrhea. Okay, so just to, like in the words, the same image that we have discussed over there. Okay, so chloride uptake occurs via the 1 sodium 1 potassium 2 chloride cotransporter, that is called as the NKCC. Okay, and the chloride exit via the cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance channel, okay, regulator, and that is the CFTR, as well as via other chloride channels. The CFTR channel that is defective in the disease of cystic fibrosis, okay, so this is the disease condition, cystic fibrosis, is quantitatively most important and is activated by what? The protein kinase A. That means it is stimulated by the cyclic AMP through the adenylyl cyclase, okay, through the adenylyl cyclase. Okay, so what happens in the cholera toxin or the cholera toxin condition? What happens? The cholera bacillus produces toxin, okay, toxin that produces prolonged stimulation of the adenylyl cyclase. Okay, adenylyl cyclase will be stimulated, so this is getting stimulated, okay, and a marked increase in the intracellular cyclic AMP concentration, thus causing increased activation of the chloride channel. And in addition to increased chloride secretion, the function of the sodium hydrogen exchange that we have seen before in the electroneutral sodium secretion, right? Okay, so in carrier for the sodium is reduced, thus reducing the NaCl absorption. So the resultant increase in the electrolyte and water content of the intestinal contents causes diarrhea. So that is the reason for the diarrhea in the case of cholera toxin or E. coli toxin. Okay. Now, what is the treatment approach for this? Okay, so when you get like these toxins, okay, so the point over here, however, the sodium potassium ATPase and the sodium glucose transporter is not affected, because the cholera toxin etc. does not affect the sodium glucose transporter. Okay, so this is also a secondary active transporter, sodium glucose, okay, which is depending on the primary active. So this primary active transporter or the secondary active transporter, that is sodium glucose cotransporter, is not affected by the toxin. So the coupled reabsorption of glucose and sodium bypasses this effect. Okay, this defect of the toxin is like bypassed by this sodium glucose. So what is the physiological basis of the treatment of sodium and water loss in diarrhea? Is oral administration of solution containing sodium and the glucose. Okay, like sometimes referred to as the what? Oral rehydration solution. Okay, or even like a grandma's solution, like, you know, in the olden days people used to take what? Rice soup with salt. Okay, or some soup with salt, which is starch and the salt. Okay, that means glucose with sodium. Okay, or you can see over here, the cereals containing carbohydrates are also useful in the treatment of diarrhea. Okay, so some potassium is secreted into the intestinal lumen, especially as a component of mucus. Okay, so mucus includes some potassium as well as what? Bicarbonate. Remember the bicarbonate. Okay, potassium and the bicarbonate. Okay, and component of mucus, as a part of the mucus. So loss of the ileal or the colonic fluids in the chronic diarrhea can lead to severe hypokalemia. Okay, and when you are losing the bicarbonate, it will lead into acidosis. Okay, acidosis. So severe diarrhea will cause hypokalemia and acidosis. Okay. Now we are done with the secretions of the large intestine. So we will start with the movements that takes place in the large intestine, movements of the colon. Okay, so the main thing is the mixing movements that takes place. Okay, and haustrations, you know, like the haustration means what? Constriction means like this. These circular muscles, okay, like intermittently present circular muscles that makes the haustrations. Okay, so the haustrations is otherwise referred to as the segmental movements, okay, that move large bowel contents between compartments caused by the combined contraction of the intermittent circular muscles and longitudinal strips of muscles. The longitudinal strips of muscles is otherwise called as the tinea coli. Okay, maybe in your anatomy you might have studied to follow the tinea coli to locate the appendix, etc. Right? So that tinea coli is the longitudinal strip of muscles, okay, and helps in exposing all the fecal matter to surface of large intestine, by which the fluid and the dissolved substances can be absorbed, especially the fluid and the electrolytes can be absorbed. So that process we have seen before, right? How to absorb. Okay. So in addition to that, like segmentation contractions, okay, we have propulsive movements. Okay, we have the propulsive movements. Okay, so in addition to the normal like peristalsis, here we have an additional type called as the mass movements. Okay, so which is like modified peristalsis. Okay, constrictive ring of contraction initiates in the transverse colon. Distal to this region, the colon loses the haustrations and constrict as a unit. Okay, so a whole series of mass movement persists for 10 to 30 minutes and then ceases. Okay, so that is like a whole movement to like a housekeeping to clean it up. Okay, so that is like a mass movement. So what causes this mass movements? What initiates the mass movement? Mass movements are initiated by the gastrocolic and the duodenocolic reflexes. So when the food comes to the stomach, you get the mass movements. When you when the food comes to the duodenum, then you get the mass movements. Okay, so normally every individual will get like the defecation urge when the food comes to the stomach or when the food is going from the stomach. Okay, so these are the time when the person get the urge for defecation, but because of the social circumstances and the habits, people may not defecate each and every time the food reaches to the stomach. But that is like a rule that is like normally seen in the small kids, okay, in the babies. What happens when the food is going to the stomach, they get the defecation reflex and they defecate. Okay, so that is described over here. So the distension of the stomach by food initiates the contraction of the rectum and frequently a desire to defecate. So the response is called the gastrocolic reflex and may be amplified by the action of gastrin on the colon, but not so significant, but this is mainly neuronal. It's believed to be like mainly neuronal. Okay, and because of the response, defecation after meals is the rule in children. In adults, the habit and the cultural factors play a large role in determining when the defecation occurs. Okay, so let's discuss the other file. So previously we have discussed the now about the diarrhea. Okay, diarrhea that can be caused by toxins and other reasons we have discussed. So now let us discuss a little bit about the opposite condition called as the constipation. Okay, so constipation like sometimes can be like hormonal, for example when there is a thyroid hormone problem, or like when the contractility of the GI tract is decreased, etc., can cause constipation. Okay, so many normal humans defecate only once in every 2 to 3 days. This is quite normal. Okay, and even others defecate once a day, and some people will defecate like 3 times a day. Okay, so these are all like normal habit. Like, so just now we have seen before in the kid, as soon as the food comes, you get a gastrocolic reflex and the colon will create the urge and the child may defecate. Okay, so that is quite common. So it's like habitual. Okay, it's make habitual. So then what is the meaning of the word constipation? Constipation refers to pathological decrease in bowel movements. So if the person have a specific habit, and if it does not happen in that specific habit, then the person may complain it as constipation. So may occur due to any underlying organic disease. It was previously considered to reflect changes in the motility alone. So motility is one of the still the factor, like in the case of a hormonal conditions. Okay, but the recent success of a drug designed to enhance chloride secretion for the treatment of chronic constipation suggests alterations in the balance between secretion and absorption in the colon could also contribute to symptom generation. Okay, and normally in the normal person, the only symptoms caused by constipation are slight anorexia and mild abdominal discomfort and distension. Symptoms other than these are due to anxiety or other causes. So normally what happens, if the food like the fecal matter comes to the rectum, it will create the urge. for defecation. But if you ignore the urge, what will happen? It will stay there and cause the distension, okay, and starts to absorb the water. Again, the new fecal matter will come over there, and if the urge is like ignored, again it will distend. Okay, it's not like the urinary bladder. In the next chapter, we will study about the urinary bladder, where it can distend, and once it reaches to the extreme capacity of it, it will automatically evacuate. But the rectum will not do that. Okay, so you need to have the voluntary component for that. Okay, so let us look at into those like voluntary component. What is the voluntary component over here? You have two components, that is the involuntary and the voluntary. So this voluntary component, that is the puborectalis, voluntary muscle, skeletal muscle involved. Okay, the puborectalis muscle. Okay, so what we normally do for the defecation? Okay, so what we have to do? We have to increase the anorectal angle. Okay, so but here you may think that it is increasing. That is not how we mention, okay, in the textbooks or in like this angle. This is your resting angle. This angle that you see over here between the rectum and the anus, this anorectal angle. Okay, what is this then? This is you are reducing the angle. Okay, maybe in the image you may feel like it is increasing the angle, but it's not like that. You are reducing the angle. So for example, if this is the angle, okay, and if you make it like straight like this, there is no angle here, right? So that is the point. So moving from this scenario to this scenario, we normally refer as reducing the angle, or like no angle is being there. Okay, so this is almost like a 90 degree, and this is like a 0 degree. So that's why we call it as like a reducing angle. So during the straining process, what we actually do to the anorectal angle, we reduce the angle. How do we reduce the angle? By relaxing the puborectalis muscle. Okay, so that is the importance of taking the position to defecate. Okay, so by doing that, what we are trying to do, we are trying to relax the puborectalis muscle. Okay, and once you take the position using by relaxing the puborectalis muscle, then what we have the external anal sphincter, okay, which has to be relaxed. So these two contributes towards the skeletal muscle component, that is the voluntary component. Okay, and the internal anal sphincter is smooth muscle in nature. Okay, so we will discuss how this external and the anal sphincter and the internal anal sphincter is regulated. Okay, so now do we need to do the Valsalva manoeuvre? Valsalva manoeuvre is like keeping the glottis closed and trying to expire out, so it will create pressure inside the abdomen. Okay, so normally what we advise to the patients is not to do the Valsalva manoeuvre. Okay, so when the patient go for a defecation, we are not advising the patient not to do the Valsalva manoeuvre. Okay, they should not do that. When the person do the Valsalva manoeuvre, it will create a high pressure over here and the engorgement of the blood vessels and high risk for hemorrhoids and fissures, etc. Okay, so that's why the Valsalva manoeuvre has to be ignored or avoided by the patient. Okay, so now let us see what are the reflexes or the neuronal component that contributes towards this. Okay, so first, when the food comes over here, okay, and causes the urge. Okay, when the fecal matter, when it comes to the rectum, it creates the urge. Okay, so the urge is carried by the from the stretch receptors through the pelvic splanchnic nerve. Okay, then it goes to the brain as well as to the spinal cord. So normally it can work as a spinal reflex. Okay, which part of the spinal cord? It goes to the sacral region, S2 to S4. Okay, and from there, and also there is like a component that is coming from the brain that can control your motor external part, but the internal sphincters is controlled directly over here. Okay, from the S2 to S4. So it is, when it is starting from S2 and S4, it is always parasympathetic, because you know the sympathetic starts from where? Thoracolumbar. Sacral is always parasympathetic. So thoracolumbar is sympathetic, whereas the craniosacral is parasympathetic. So it is a sacral, so it has to be parasympathetic only. Okay, so no involvement of the sympathetic at this part, like very less involved. Okay, so it is coming from the parasympathetic. Okay, and causes what? Contraction or stimulation of the rectum and inhibition or the relaxation of the internal sphincter. Okay, the internal sphincter will be relaxed. Okay, so in addition to that, you have the impulse either from this reflex and from the motor, like coming from the upper motor neuron, will stimulate the somatomotor response that is there in the pudendal nerve. Okay, the pudendal nerve will cause what? The external sphincter, the external anal sphincter, to be relaxed. Okay, so that is the role of the pudendal nerve. So once you relax the external sphincter, then you defecate. Okay, so let's discuss like one question that explained to you about these reflex and other aspects of this defecation. Okay, regarding the defecation, let us discuss one question. Okay, so over here, a 84-year-old female complains of the rectal pain. She has a history of moderate cognitive impairment secondary to Alzheimer's dementia. She lives in a nursing home but proves to be regularly independent during the day, although she does require 24-hour supervision. Okay, so recently she has been displaying stool withholding behavior. Okay, she is withholding the fecal matter. Okay, so last week she passed a large bowel movement that resulted in anal fissure. So anal fissure may be painful, so that may be the reason for the withholding behavior. Okay, since then she has refused to communicate with the nursing staff when she feels the urge. So she is refusing to go for the defecation because of the anal fissure and because of the pain, and she is showing the behavior of withholding it. Okay, now there is a plan to use lidocaine. Lidocaine is an anesthetic cream. Okay, so lidocaine cream to temporarily anesthetize the fissure so that she can have bowel movement. However, it is difficult to get her to remember and comply with the plan because the old age and have cognitive impairment of Alzheimer's dementia. Okay, so she have Alzheimer's dementia, so she doesn't even remember to comply with the plan. Okay, so that is the plan, but she does not comply with that. So if she continues the withholding behavior, there is a withholding behavior, which of the following is the most likely outcome? Okay, so if she withheld, so what will happen? There will be continual hardening of the stool as water is absorbed. Yes, that is true. Okay, so what will happen if the fecal matter stays in the rectum? Okay, and if the external sphincter is not relaxed, what will happen? It will keep accumulating. Okay, even it can accumulate like the size of a football or something like that. And we call that condition as what? Fecal impaction. It gets impacted over there because the water keeps on getting absorbed. Okay, now eventual involuntary mass emptying of the rectum. No, because it will happen eventually. The mass emptying of the rectum can happen provided her skeletal muscles, those like puborectalis muscles and external anal sphincter, is weak or like paralyzed. Okay, then evacuation can happen. But in this case, no, in this case it won't happen. Okay, small amount of stool passed as volume exceeds the capacity of the colon. No, that is true if it was urinary bladder. Okay, this phenomenon is true in a urinary bladder but not with the rectum. Okay, small amount of the urine will be passed out when the volume is exceeding. Okay, but that is not true with here. Okay, so ongoing internal sphincter relaxation until conscious defecation. No, ongoing internal sphincter relaxation may not even take place because once it relaxes, again the reflex, it will dilate and hold the fecal matter, so it won't take place like that. Okay, it won't. Okay, so hostration adjust to ensure adequate mixing of remaining stool. No, it won't mix at this point because towards the rectum the hostration is not there, and then it won't mix up the stool or something. Instead it's hold it and start absorbing the water, keep absorbing the water. It may not mix it up again. Okay, so this is also not the correct option. Okay, so hope you understood this logic of this question. Okay, and that's about the defecation reflex. Okay, so now we have completed the whole series of like videos that describes the physiology of the digestive system. Okay, thank you. Have a nice day. Bye.